Hello students, so we are here again with the second part of our poem Thing of Beauty by John Keats. First part we have already done, so let's straight away start with the second part. In the first part I told that whenever we see sadness in our life we become gloomy, and then poet says we start our searching for the beautiful things. And beautiful things in nature only. So now we start from here, page number 98, second last line. Now here poet gives a long list. This also is important. From board's point of view, you may get this question for 2 marks, that make a long list of all beautiful things which according to poet are there to make our heart very happy. Whenever we are sad, maybe these things would make us forget our gloomy days, okay, or maybe it will bring us out from the darkness. So let's start from here. Such the sun, the moon, trees old and young and sprouting a shady boon. He says then we start searching for beautiful things in nature. Now in the list, at the top is sun. He says, sometime when we look at the bright sun, when we look at the rising sun, even when we look at the time when the sun is setting, maybe all these scenes look very beautiful, and maybe at that time we forget about our sadnesses. We forget about all our troubles and we just are lost in the beauty of sun only. Okay, the bright sun, the sun rays, or maybe the setting sun. But it will certainly make us forget our worries. The moon. Then he says, the next beautiful thing in nature is moon. Whether this is full moon or half moon, whatever, the moon always looks beautiful. Okay, in the company of stars. In the sky, in the night, when we look at moon, maybe for some time we forget about our pains. Trees old and young. Then he says, if you look at young trees, if you look at old trees, okay, young trees means very small in height, old trees which are maybe 100 years old, okay, big trees. So whatever kind of tree it is, as it is a part of nature, it certainly make us forget our worries. So all these plants, all these trees would make us forget our pains. So we feel good, we feel happy. Sprouting a shady boon. Then he says, sometime when there is shade, when we, especially when the this is summer season and it's very hot and we stand under some shade, we feel good. Okay, that shade is like a boon in our life. Okay, because that shade would bring relief in our life. For simple sheep. Now, this shade can be for human beings. Even sometime animals also, they stand under the shade of the trees. Okay, and here he has taken the one animal only, that is sheep. Okay, because sheep is considered very innocent animals. That's why he has taken one sheep, one animal only. But actually he is trying to say that all the animals, they are also part of nature. That's why when we look at animals, when we play with animals, okay, we forget about our own troubled days. So he says, when we ourselves stand under the shady boon or shady tree, it becomes a boon for us. Or sometime when we look at animals, okay, like sheep, when they are sitting under the shade, and when we look at this scene, we forget about our own worries. And such are daffodils. Because now he's making a list only of beautiful things. Then he says, next beautiful thing is the daffodil flowers. Actually, daffodil, Wordsworth also has written, you know, many poems on the beauty of daffodils. So daffodils are actually very beautiful flowers, small flowers. And he says, if we look at these beautiful flowers, then also we forget about our worries. Okay. With the green world they live in, especially he says in the greenery, when there is too much greenery and then you see small daffodil flowers, you are transported into some other world. you forget about your worries and you feel very elated, very joyful, very happy. And clearance that for themselves a cooling covert make. And then he next thing he takes clear rills. Clear means transparent water. Rills means small streams. Jo chote chote jharne girte hain. He says if you look at the small streams where the water is very transparent, it gives a very cooling effect to our hearts. Okay, that for themselves a cooling covert make against a hot season, especially when the season is very hot. So, and cooling covert make, covert actually means bushes. So, you say suppose the water is falling from a height. Okay, when the water is falling down, it's not that the water is falling down straight away at one particular place only. Now, when the water is coming down, maybe the water is sprinkled here and there also. And on the bushes also, the water drops you can see. And when you see the water drops here and there, scattered here and there on the bushes, on the leaves, so those drops make the whole area very cool. Okay, so he says that coolness you can feel in your heart also. Okay, when you look at some water, clear water, transparent water, it gives you that cool effect. And this is all part of nature. And you will forget your own worries. Against the hot season, the mid-forest brake, rich with a sprinkling of fair musk rose blooms. Now, next thing he takes, mid-forest brake. Brake is, we can say, thick ferns. Okay. Jisko Hindi mein bolte jhaadiyan. So, sometime, mid means amidst, we can say, other plants or in the middle of the forest. So, he says, sometime in the middle of the forest, you sometime see there are thick ferns and there, these thick ferns seem very rich. Rich with what? Rich with a sprinkling of fair musk rose blooms. Sprinkling as if someone has spread small blooms means small flowers. Fair means very beautiful. Musk rose means rosy color, rosy shape. Small blooms, small flowers. He says sometime even in the forest. Okay, and sometime there are so many thick ferns and there only, because in the forest there is no gardener. The seeds sometime they come with the wind only. Okay, and sometime these seeds are sprouted over there when the right time comes. We have read in the last poem. Okay, so sometime you see in the forest small flowers and it seems as if these flowers are scattered here and there. And it adds to the beauty of the forest. So he says, sometime you feel that the place is made rich, that forest is made grand with those small flowers which seems to be sprinkled here and there. He says, all these things when you look at, you forget your own miseries. Okay, when sometime when you feel disappointed. So here he says, this is the contrast comes in our life. On one hand, we feel disappointed when we see that there is no nobility left. But then, when we look at beautiful things, we can say rewarded by nature, then we forget about our own miseries and pains. So this is the long list. So I'm repeating the list. List is sun, moon, trees, which are old, which are young, then sometimes the heavy shade, then even the small animals, and then some daffodil flowers, or sometimes some streams, rills, and sometimes even the coverts, bushes, and even sometimes the thick ferns, the brakes, and then lastly he says musk rose blooms. So this is very obvious for us also to understand, this is all part of nature. But now here he has added one more thing, which according to the poet is part of nature only. Okay, and such too is the grandeur of the dooms. Dooms means ruins. Khandhar, he says, sometime when you look at the ruins, okay, which tell the story of great people, they tell the story of great soldiers, they tell the story of great kings. So when you visit some ruins there, then you get to know about the story behind those buildings. And even those stories give us motivation. they give us somewhere some kind of motivation, somewhere some kind of happiness. Okay, we feel a different kind of satisfaction when we get to know about the history of those places. Such too is the grandeur. Grandeur means greatness. He says sometime you feel the greatness of those tombs, of those ruins. And especially now he has told what kind of ruins we have imagined for the mighty dead. Especially those buildings which are made in the memory of mighty people. Mighty people means those who die for the good cause. Mighty means actually brave. So those brave people who die for the country, who die for the society, who die for other good things. Okay, they lay their life, they sacrifice their life. He says when we get to know the stories about their sacrifices, we get a kind of motivation. And this motivation give a peace to our hearts. Okay, so we have imagined for the mighty dead all lovely tales that we have heard of it. He says whatever tales, whatever stories, beautiful stories, we read about them, we hear about them, it certainly gives us a kind of peace. An endless fountain of immortal drink pouring unto us from the heaven's brink. Now he says, we can say, we can take it that way, that heaven is continuously sending a kind of, now we can say, fountain. Okay, endless fountain. This is a kind of endless fountain which is continuously coming to us from the heaven. Okay, pouring unto us means coming down, okay, on this earth. And this is actually, he has here talked about immortal drink. Immortal drink is that nectar, okay, which we, when nectar we drink, what does it mean? If we drink nectar, it means the life will become immortal. But now here he says, this nectar is nectar of nature, okay. Means he says, God has sent nature on this earth and continuously this nature is with us. And it is kind of nectar which is given to us on this earth. And this nature, this nectar certainly makes our happiness, joy of the heart immortal. Actually, that nectar which we have read in the mythology, okay, that nectar gives permanent, we can say, life to any human being. Okay, that's right, it is not with the human being, this is with the gods only, angels only. So here he is talking about another kind of nectar. He says nature is also kind of nectar, because if we remain in the lap of nature, our joys get a permanence over here. Means our joys never die. He doesn't say that man would never die. He says actually then our joys would never die. Our joys would become immortal if we are always in the lap of nature. So this nature, he says, actually God has sent like nectar, or he's continuously sending like nectar on this earth. So we should always be in the company of nature, be in the lap of nature, because it works as a nectar and it will make our happiness, a joyful moments, permanent moments. Okay, they will never let our joys die. I think you have understood this poem. So very quickly, nutshell in Hindi. So यहाँ poet क्या कहने की कोशिश कर रहा है कि जितनी भी खूबसूरत चीजें हैं वो हमेशा रहती हैं, उनकी कभी death नहीं होती, वो मरती नहीं है. क्यों? क्योंकि खूबसूरती हमारे दिमाग में हमेशा के लिए बस जाती है. और जब भी हम उस खूबसूरत चीजों को याद करते हैं तो हम अपनी गम उस वक्त के भूल जाते हैं और हम उन्हीं चीजों में खो जाते हैं. तो यहाँ पोइट ने किस खूबसूरत चीज़ों की बात की है? नेचर की. उसने बहुत लंबी लिस्ट बना के दी है कि नेचर में ये सारी चीज़ें खूबसूरत हैं. और ये जब सब चीज़ें जब हमें मिलती हैं या हम इनकी कंपनी में रहते हैं तो हम अपने वरीज को, अपनी टेंशन्स को, अपने दुखों को भूल जाते हैं. और इसलिए उसने कहा कि कोशिश करनी चाहिए कि आप नेचर की गोद में रहें. क्यों? क्योंकि उसने कहा, और उसने साथ में एक और ऐड किया कि नेचर तो है, लेकिन कहता कभी कभी आप उन ब्रेव लोगों की, उन बहादुर लोगों की जब कहानियां सुनते हो, उनकी जो याद में बिल्डिंग्स बनी होती हैं, उनकी याद में अगर कोई जगह पे आप जाते हो तो आप उनकी स्टोरी सुन के, पढ़ के आपको एक अंदर से सेटिस्फेक्शन मिलती है और एक वो मोटिवेशन मिलता है जो आपको एक्चुअली पीस देता है. इसलिए वो कहता है कि ये जो नेचर है इसको इस तरह से लेना चाहिए कि ये हमारे लिए इस धरती पर अमृत है. क्योंकि अमृत हम हेवन में जाके ला नहीं सकते, लेकिन शायद गॉड ने ये अमृत यहाँ पर धरती पर नेचर के रूप में हमारे लिए भेजा है. और हमें इस अमृत को हमेशा ग्रहण करते रहना चाहिए, ताकि हमें हमेशा हमारी खुशियों को कभी नजर ना लगे, खुशियां हमारी खत्म ना हो और हम हमेशा खुश रहें। आई होप यू हैव अंडरस्टूड। नाउ यू गिव 2-3 रीडिंग, सीरियस रीडिंग्स, देन यू विल बी एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड द पॉइंट। थैंक यू।